Welcome to a Bible talk from Lower Mountains Anglican Church.
Welcome back. Certainly a bit of a mess to clean up as usual from if you've had kids at home with you for the whole time during lockdown and houses sort of descend into chaos, you'll know what I'm talking about. Ian might know a little bit what I'm talking about too. One of those families with kids at home during lockdown.
Plenty of chaos, plenty of mess.
They're excited to see you on TV. You can wave and say hello. Now, Ian's going to be reading the Bible for us in just a moment before Ken speaks to us. We're talking, as you heard, about the grace, kind of the toolbox that holds all the essential beliefs and items that we hold dear as Christians.
I thought Ken did pretty good, by the way.
Yeah. It wasn't bad. It was improvising, but that's what you do.
It's not the standard tools. So.
No. Yeah. It was a little bit of a setup. Yeah. Tell me about grace in your life. What's the significance of grace to you?
Grace, obviously, I think as a Christian, is so significant. I can appreciate that God is perfect, and we can see that in the Bible, and I know that I am far from perfect, and so there's a break, I suppose, in the relationship there, and so I'm so thankful that God is gracious to me and to us by sending Jesus to die for us, and we can have a relationship with God, and if he wasn't so gracious, then I think, it wouldn't really work.
You would be in a lot of trouble.
A lot of trouble, yeah.
All right, well, you're going to read for us from Romans chapter 5, 1 to 11, one of the most, I guess one of those purple passages of the Bible, one that often is quoted and remembered, but very important to sort of draw together this big idea that we're talking about today. So I'll let you go with that.
Thanks, Romans Dave.
5.
Okay, Romans 5, 1 to 11. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand, and we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for the righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if, while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his Son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation.
Well, hello, friends. Welcome to our new Bible Talk series, DiscipleWORKS The Essential Christian. How is it that discipleship works? Over the next 9 weeks, we're going to be looking at 9 essential elements which any disciple of Jesus could consider as a mark of what it means to be a disciple. That means that if you are not someone who would boldly say that you are a Christian, then you can listen in here and consider what makes a Christian different to the next person. And perhaps by the end of the time that we meet as looking over this particular passage, you might actually want to think about what it means for you to be a Christian, and I'd love to be able to give you that space. And if you are someone who is new to faith, then I want you to be able to listen in here and consider what you need to make sure you put in place as a person of faith to get the foundations right, so to speak. And if you're a person of faith in Jesus, then perhaps you've been, well, maybe you've been a Christian for some time, which is a great thrill, then you can listen in and do maybe a spiritual stock take of sorts, and perhaps examine your attitudes and activities as a disciple, and ask yourself if there is anything that you need to spiritually clean up so that you do that stock take. Regardless, I hope that you individually and perhaps as a church will be clear on why and what we do essentially as disciples of Christ. Let's pray as we come to this word now. Lord and Father, we are called to gather because of what you have done for us and for the world in Jesus. Whenever we stand with you, we ask that you would give us minds, hearts, and hands which are ready to listen, open to change, and willing to act. We ask this because of Jesus. Amen.
I've loved, I've laughed and cried, I've had my fill, my share of losing, and now as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way, oh no, oh no, not me, I did it my way. For what?
Friends, in March 1969, now just in case you're interested, that was before I was born. So this song is quite an old song. Frank Sinatra released this song. It's called My Way. And it became the self-determination anthem of the generation and remained in the top 75 best-selling songs for an astonishing 149 weeks. That is the second longest of all time. My Way captured the idea that nothing in life matters more than living on your own terms. Well, that song became Frank Sinatra's signature song. Yet his daughter is reported to say that her father hated the song and thought it was self-serving and self-indulgent. You know, interestingly, as recently as 2019, and so that gives you an idea, 50 years of that song, it was listed as the most popular funeral song. If there was ever an anthem that spoke to our times, even 50 years later, that was a song before its age. Friends, our essential topic today is one which calls the Christian person to think in a very different way to the world around us. For essentially, Christians are saved by faith. My Way is as close to an anathema for the Christian person as it would be for the hymn Amazing Grace to be played on repeat in hell. And why? Because that very popular idea that we are the master or mistresses of our own domain, that inherent desire to be in control of all things, that familiar position that we are good people, so good that God would be honored to have us by his side, that what I do, my way, gains me credit points, which secures my salvation in heaven and somehow gains me that luxury suite on Pearly White Avenue. The Christian person should have a completely opposite view, and with good reason. For Christians believe that we are saved by grace and not by our efforts. Christians believe that they have been given the greatest gift freely and not because we've had to pay. Salvation for grace is a truth that is one of the most liked, but also one of the most badly applied truths of the Bible. It's liked because it speaks of God's gracious work to save, to taking a person who is at best an enemy and giving them everything as if they were his best friend. What is not to like about that particular truth? What is not to like about this doctrine? But it is badly applied because it is so easy to assume that because God is loving, that he will save everyone. Or on the other hand, that because God has saved, that people no longer need to obey him. The doctrine of salvation by grace is one of the many points where the Bible is totally out of step with our society. And I want to show you three ways in which this doctrine rubs the world up the wrong way. And we'll get to that by looking at what the Apostle Paul wrote in Romans 5, which you heard Jemima read for us just before. Can I ask that you open that before you? On the Sunday Hub, there is an outline for those that love to be able to see the outline and take notes. And I hope that you'll be able to see what God says in this text as we work our way through it. So, Romans chapter 5. Let me show you the first reason salvation by grace is out of step with the world. It is because the Bible says that we can do nothing to earn favor with God. We are saved by faith, not our works. Look at the very first verse. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Justified by faith, justified through faith, is a fancy way of saying that a person is friends with God, a person is mates with God again. Now, how does that happen? We are justified through faith, through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, at the very start of that verse, you'll see the therefore, which tells you that the argument is based on something that has already been said. Now, this is the reason why it's helpful to have a Bible open in front of you. If you were to flip back into the chapter before, you would see that that passage written by the Apostle Paul to the Christians in Rome, many who have Jewish origins, so that makes them descendants of Israel, they would have grown up knowing their Old Testament history, their Old Testament scriptures, describing how God had saved them. Now, as a quick history lesson, the father of Israel was a guy. Well, can you see it there in chapter 4? The father of Israel was a guy called Abraham. Abraham is mentioned as one who heard God's original promise that he would save his people. And what Paul does is explain how God credited Abraham as a righteous person, how he declared him to be righteous. You can see that in chapter 4, verse 3. Now, what he does in this particular verse is he lifts from their Old Testament scriptures right back in Genesis chapter 15, and he says, what does that scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Now, what is significant about this is that at the time Abraham was credited as being righteous, Abraham had done nothing that would give him credit points. He had not worked for it. There was no law to show how obedient he was. That came later with Moses. There was no birthmark. He had no special sign that marked him out, like circumcision would mark him out or mark them out in the following generations. And yet he believed. And by his faith, he was declared righteous. The point here is that God declared Abraham on the basis of faith to be right with him, not on the basis of any effort on Abraham's part. And so for the Christians in Rome, and right through to today, wherever we might be sitting listening to this, God justifies through faith, through Jesus, not because of our efforts. Now that is a very, very different picture to the story that we hear every day in the context that we might live in, wherever we are in the world. You need to be able to do things to be seen to be good. you must earn it. So at school, it is the homework or the exams that you complete that determine how high you are towards the top of the class, how good you are. At uni, it's the essays, it's the assignments which determine your results. At work, it's the promotion or the KPIs that you need to meet in order to be able to get to the point where they'd be happy to give you a pay rise. And so it goes. That is the way our world works. You do, therefore you get rewarded in some way for your efforts. But with God, it is not our efforts, it is through faith in Christ. The second way that salvation by grace is totally out of step with the world has to do with hope. Go back to Romans 5 and look at the connection that verse 2 makes between grace and hope. You can see there, we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand and we boast in the hope of the glory of God. So we have access by faith into this grace into which we now stand. You can see that it is a present reality for those in faith. They now stand. Our world tells us to think of hope sort of like wishful thinking. I really hope that I will win the lotto. But that is not the Bible's view of hope at all. Hope is a sure thing because of God's grace in Jesus. You know how much the whole lotto system would be completely changed if we knew every time we bought a lotto ticket that that lotto ticket would be the winner. If that was the case, everyone would be scrambling to go and buy it. And with God, the Bible's view of hope is that that lotto ticket is always a winner. Look at what that means for the person of faith. Boast, or if you've got an older translation, rejoice. Boast in the hope of the glory of God. Now, whenever a person of faith speaks out or declares that they have faith in Jesus, that is an example of someone who boasts in the hope of the glory of God. LMAP at 6 has had a whole bunch of people get baptized in the last 12 months or so, and we've had a whole bunch of people get confirmed. They are all examples of people who boast in the hope of the glory of God. Yet it's not only in those formal ceremonies. Every time you speak up about your hope in Jesus, at home, in the workplace, at school, in uni, at the on the sporting field, in a social event, you are boasting in the hope of the glory of God. You are boasting because you've got a sure hope. You've got a sure thing. And there's more, which you can see there from verse 3. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings because we know that suffering produces perseverance, and perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. This is one of the most fundamental passages in me taking Jesus seriously. I love this passage. Those who have faith have reason to see the glory in sufferings because we know that suffering builds perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope, which does not disappoint. Is that not strange to our ears? To glory in suffering? Consider our dear brothers and sisters in some areas around the world who are not only pressured but persecuted for their faith. There are numerous stories of Christians in India, North Korea, Iraq, Nigeria, Afghanistan, Myanmar, and more who have been told that they have to give up their faith or get out lest they be put to death. I wonder how many of the hundreds of refugees heading towards Australia fleeing from the Taliban are Christian believers. They can rejoice, they can boast, because hope for them is not wishful thinking. It is a sure thing. They have being given by God's grace. You see, the hope on offer in our world is lost when suffering comes. You know, we can enjoy so much of what is on offer in the world. It's all fantastic. But then when we suffer, when I get sick, when I get to the point where even, heaven forbid, I might die, then at that point, all hope is lost. But with Jesus, suffering cannot take away Christian hope. Because even if it gets as bad as you get to the point of death, there is more. There is life forever with God. That is hope. That is a gift worth having. And it's also a reality that connects the what we know of suffering that we see all around and actually gives us an answer to suffering that seems to be completely out of the realm of what our world offers. If you are looking for a passage that connects that reality in suffering to that reality of what it means to have hope in any form, then Romans 5 holds those two seemingly incongruent ideas together. That is your passage. That's one of the reasons why it was such an incredibly important passage for me in becoming a believer in Jesus. Because it took my reality, what suffering I understood, to a hope that seemed to give me an answer. The third reason salvation by grace is out of step with the world is it because it tells us something about ourselves. And friends, it tells us something about ourselves which deep down we know to be true even if we don't like to admit it. I hope you'll be willing to continue to listen to me as I say something that really is a bit of a truth bomb. And that is that we know we are out of step with God. Look at verse 6 and then verse 8. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. It is not a very popular idea to think of ourselves as sinners. I quite like thinking of myself as a good person, and I'm sure you do too. I walk out there into the streets of the lower mountains. For those that are gathered in parks somewhere around the lower mountains out there, hello. They ask a passerby, do you see yourself as a good person? And apart from the funny look that you will get, I bet that the most popular answer that you will hear is, yes, I'm a good person. We are generally good people, give or take the occasional traffic infringement or COVID discretion or the swear word that we let slip out. Yes, we are good people. But I'm not sure anyone would want to put up their hand and say, ask me if I'm perfect. I'm perfect. Ask me. Nobody's going to do that. And that is the point. If not perfect, then a sinner. And this passage is reminding us that deep down we are powerless, ungodly, and sinners. I'm sorry to put it so bluntly. I'm taking the text that we have here. That's effectively the diagnosis of the human condition. Powerless, ungodly, sinners. And if you would like to have evidence for that, then pick up the local newspaper. So, how do mostly good, but let's dial this back a little bit. How do mostly good people, if not by their efforts, come to have peace with the one who is perfect? The answer to that is that Jesus took our place. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. You see, Jesus did not need to die for a righteous man. He had to die as a righteous man in order that mostly good people might be seen completely righteous in God's sight. That is the extraordinary gift of the gospel. That is the good news. That is, in fact, what the whole Bible is about. That Jesus would die for those who see themselves as righteous and good, that he would also die for those who were honest enough to recognize that they were unrighteous and ungodly, in fact, enemies with God. And friends, that good news is the most extraordinary trade in history. It is Jesus who traded his perfect life for my and your imperfect life. Not because I or you are so wonderful, but because he was so extraordinary. What does it mean to be saved through faith by God's grace? Well, you can see why that is so important in the next few verses if you move to verse 9. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if, while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we now have received reconciliation. It means that God, through Jesus and only through Jesus, has made the effort to save us. It is his gift at his cost, freely given to us. When someone works at a job, they receive a payment for what they've done. They earn their pay. You would never say that that paycheck was a gift. By works, we get what we deserve. We've earned it. That is exactly why Paul states here and in other places that faith is the opposite to works. Because by works, we get what we deserve. But in faith, we get what we don't deserve. In faith, we get something even better. Let me push this just a little further, and then we're going to apply it. While faith is opposite to works, faith is also opposite to disobedience. And that is why when someone becomes a person of faith, the right response is to obey Jesus. After all, why would you trust Jesus to remove your sin and guilt before God if you're only then going to hold on to that sin and continue to disobey God day after day? When Jesus started his public ministry, when he was sort of announced to the world and you saw him as an adult go out there and start proclaiming, the very first words that he said were these in Mark chapter 1. The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news. Jesus calls people to repent, that is to turn away from that which is wrong, and to believe, that is to place their trust in him. Repentance involves seeing sin for the deceitful and deadly thing that it really is, and so turning away from it. Belief in Jesus involves seeing Jesus for the gracious and powerful Savior that he really is, and so turning to him. These two acts go together in a person's salvation. Repentance and belief. They are two sides of the same coin, if you like. Have you ever noticed that when you turn from something, you turn two ways? You know, suppose you are walking to your front door when you suddenly remember that you've left your keys on the bench. When you turn to go back, you are turning away from the front door and you are turning toward your keys. Every turning involves turning from something to something. That is what saving faith looks like. It involves turning from the horror of sin, and it involves turning to trust and hope in Jesus. Or to put it another way, a saving faith involves turning from that which is out of step with God and turning to Jesus, who brings you in step with God and into peace with Him. Now, perhaps you'd like to push back here and say something like this. Isn't repenting and believing both human actions? To which I would say this. Repenting and believing in Christ are not works. Repenting and believing in Jesus does nothing if Jesus had not already paid the price. In fact, if Jesus had not paid the price, there would be no reason to repent or believe. It is because of Jesus that salvation forever is even on offer. It is by God's grace and only by His grace that we are saved. He gives us the very reason to repent and the very reason to believe. So whoever you are, wherever you might be hearing this, let me say this, that if you understand grace, then you should be able to understand that this asks you to turn from being someone who was in step with the world to being someone who is now called to live out of step with the world. And so, if you would like to boast in this hope, now is the time to repent and believe. For this passage from Romans is written to those who do believe. And so the certainty of this hope, the certainty of this passage tells you that grace is already certain for you. But if you don't believe, then what this passage helps you to realize, I hope, is that grace is awaiting you. Repent, turn away from that which calls you to live my way, and believe in the one who calls you to live his way. This is too good a gift to miss. And yet I recognize that it asks you to humble yourself before Jesus. If you want to know how to do that, then feel free to get in touch with someone that you know in our church. Get in touch with me if you want. Go to the website. Go to the connect button that we often put up on the screen and say, I want to understand Jesus more. I want to understand what that means to humble yourself before Jesus. Or I would like to have that gift that is currently awaiting. And friends, if you boldly call yourself a Christian, then to you, stand now in the grace that you have now been given. For you have now received reconciliation with God. In the coming weeks, we're going to look at a series of essential topics, each that the Christian should tangibly be able to apply into their life. It would be a mistake to think that that wasn't also the case for this very foundational topic. If you know that you are saved by grace by the one who died for you, then surely you would understand the value of living for your life now for Him. to look for security in what he has done for you, rather than look for security in what the world asks you to do. To work hard, to do good, to serve tirelessly, to give generously, but not so that you can boast in what you have done, to boast in the hope that you are given in faith. To be obedient, because living under grace is a gift that should never be taken for granted. Don't take a gift as good as this and ignore it or misuse it. Be obedient. And finally, with such a given grace, it calls you to live out your life displaying the same kind of grace, even before those you find hardest to deal with. Live out the grace that you have been given. So, friends, who were once an enemy, you are now a friend because you have been saved by grace.
You have been listening to a Bible talk from Lower Mountains Anglican Church. If you'd like to know more about Jesus, get further information, or download other resources, please visit our website at lmap.org.au.